Welcome back to New Day. It's now time to look at the papers, and the Electoral Commission is dominating most of the headline. Well, the chair for the Electoral Commission, Madam Charlotte Asse, granted an exclusive interview to the Daily Graphic, and she said quite a number of things about, of course, the election, the steering committee. We'll spend time on that. Dr. Charles Okubrobe has also written a piece on the steering committee. We'll also spend a bit of time to look at that as well. And the EC itself has been dragged to court. The defendant in this case, of course, is the EC and the Attorney General. So let me start off with the Daily Graphic. It says here that National Election Steering Committee Platform for Information Sharing, that's the EC chair saying that. Also, voter register under scrutiny as NPP regional youth organizer heads for Supreme Court. The Finder newspaper says EC dragged to court over voters register, and Baumia shreds NDC's project claims NHIS to go up by 27% and no concrete policy for cerebral palsy children in Ghana. That's a sad, sad one there. And the Ghanaian Times newspaper says ECAG ordered to file defense over register. And the Daily Guide says George Boateng arrested, Zanetta Rollins thrown out, and EC sued over bloated register. That's the Daily Guide newspaper there. And the Business and Financial Times, Transport Ministry to re-engage TEPA over VAT, and inflation targeting policy not credible. In it, it has other stories on youth employment, which we'll spend some 10, 15 minutes to look at as well. Let me introduce my guest to you this morning. I have the president of the Accra Institute of Technology, Professor Jidonu, with us. Good morning, sir. Welcome to the show. Also, Member of Parliament for Ablekuma Central, Honorable Tese Chai, is here with us. Good morning to you and welcome to the show. And my final guest for the morning is Member of Parliament for Menchia South, Dr. Matthew Opoku-Prempeh, affectionately known as NAP. Good morning, sir. Welcome to the show. All right, then. I would want to spend time on the Daily Graphic story, which says that the EC chair says National Election Steering Committee platform for information sharing. Now, in the interview she granted, which is on page 16, she talks about how politicization, I mean, first of all, she questions what has the EC done wrong, and I would want to read just a bit of that for you. It says here that, you know, the NESC, the steering committee, is not an operational decision-making body. It's merely a platform to share information. It cannot decide, for instance, on the date of elections, the movement of ballot boxes, and any other operations of the elections, it pointed out. We'll get, you know, more details as we go on. She's granted an interview. Does that in any way clear the confusion surrounding the purpose for which the steering committee was set up?
Good morning to my
good
listeners.
Good morning.
I first wanted to know how many journalists were called for this interview.
It's an exclusive interview, so the Daily Graphic is allowed.
That in itself is not being transparent.
It's a national paper.
Yes, and so it's not. The Daily Graphic doesn't go everywhere. It probably may be the largest circulating paper, but doesn't go everywhere. And when you occupy a sensitive position like the chair of the EC, like Caesar's wife. You see, you have to be squeaky clean, because why?
Squeaky clean in what sense?
In your actions you take.
Okay.
Right. Why would you call only the Daily Graphic? What relation have you got with that reporter against all the reporters? Mm. So when you are trying to do these things,
Media houses strive to get exclusive interviews. So Daily Graphic may have made their own arrangement to get that interview. If TVT or any other media house felt it was compelling and important for them to do so,
I'm saying. If this thing has become topical, this issue of the National Election Steering Committee has become topical. It has become so topical that the last IPAC, which was not called because of that, it ended up being the dominant issue they discussed.
Okay.
So for anything, I've heard two of their own peer, Osu Pari and the lady, giving probably even conflicting statements on there. So if you are going to grant an interview, you make sure first you have all your commissioners with you. Then you speak to the issue. Then it brings a sort of a closure. But when at the IPAC, the commission members who were present there, I know that the EC chair herself was not present, the commission members who were present all decided not to be able to speak about the National Elections Steering Committee. That is why they ended up going back to the drawing board. If you read Raccoon Bobby's piece, if you speak to all the people who went to IPAC, it was because the members of the commission, and I'm talking about the EC commission, the members of the commission, not being able to advance the reason for setting up of the body. If you listen to Bernard Mona, he said that if when we are asked what is the function of this committee, the EC itself could not tell us the function of the committee they have. So it means, and if you listen behind the scenes, it means that members of the commission itself, my beef was that you all sat down to be inaugurated. And now when IPAC comes and IPAC is asking about the setting of the commission, you all pretend you don't know about it and go say that we haven't thought through and we should go back to the drawing board. It's actually left Madame Charlotte to say in the cold.
Okay.
That is why probably...
Do you think it would have been different if she was present?
Maybe. Maybe. But it also tells me two things. That the other members were not aware. Okay. You see, it is a commission. It is not a governing board or an executive something. So, or at least, carry along all your members. Let every member of the commission be able, on the person's own, speak to the issues. But if you have members of the commission there, or at least members of the management of the commission there, who cannot speak to an issue the commission has set up, it's dangerous.
Okay.
And that is why I'm saying that even granting this exclusive interview itself, it's
she
not
could
good.
Have done it she for all the media houses.
For all, at least the management, the two deputies to be there, and then speak to the issue and answer questions from journalists.
Okay, well, come, we'll definitely stay on that. Prof, I'm sure you've been following this, you know, back and forth. But there's something Madam says that I want you to just receive. She says, in the interview, she says this: what have we done wrong? Is it that we should not work to improve the situation and never correct the problems? I don't understand. If we should continue along this path of mischief, malice, and mistrust, it will be a recipe for social instability and chaos.
Against all the parties.
Yes, and chaos. The conversation that's going on, is that a feeling you're getting that we're just attacking the Electoral Commission for no apparent reason?
I think those are strong words coming from the EC chairwoman.
Okay.
She might be, there's a little bit of frustration behind that speech.
Sure.
Say, what have we done wrong? You don't use that word very often.
Sure.
I mean, children may use that word, say, what have I done for you to be working me here and there? The fact that it's coming from her means that...
it's gotten to the commission.
It's got, I mean, it's getting a little bit too hot.
Sure.
Okay, for her. And it's quite sad that we should come to that level. She just took over the job. She have not yet conducted any serious election yet.
Sure.
And I think she must be given some chance, some space.
Okay.
And that space would include a space to make some few mistakes and then have time to correct them and also make some good ones.
Okay.
I think that is the kind of space she's talking about.
Okay. But Prof, is that the reason, that fear, because of what's at stake, is that why people are also impatient and are on her neck to avoid those mistakes? However little it is, it would have dire consequences if not checked.
Well, we're not there yet.
Okay.
We are still discussing.
Okay.
Okay? She went to one paper and gave an interview. We don't know whether she went to the paper or the paper went to her, call on her.
Sure.
But the fact is that she is discussing the issue. Okay, so that we are not home yet. Okay, this committee proposal has been put on the table. Some people disagree with it. We are still discussing. That is what a democracy is all about.
Okay.
We are not home yet. Okay, as part of that discussion, she's getting a little bit frustrated that let's not be going that road. I think you want to emphasize on the point. Let's not go on that road.
On that road, yes. She said it. She even says if the EC had done something untoward and infringed on its constitutional obligations,
yes,
we must be the first to be criticized.
Yes.
But all the criticisms must be on merit and founded.
I think I agree with her.
Okay.
She's just saying what needs to be said. That okay, we may be wrong, we may be right. Have you done something constitutionally wrong? But this is a proposal. Probably may not have done it well. That is what we are discussing. So I think let's look at these things square. I mean, we are in election year. Anything election people, the chairperson says, is going to be a little bit explosive.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a bit saddened that it will come to date.
Business.
And especially she said that if we go down this road, she's seeing a little bit further.
Okay,
we are in a difficult year. We are in an election year. If we are not careful at this starting stage, the early days, we try to go this way, then I think we should take her point serious.
Okay.
And I think there's a little bit of frustration on her part, and I think we must recognize that. Let's discuss the issues. If this committee is not well constituted, if it's unconstitutional or it's not well constituted, let's discuss it.
Okay.
If the mandate that she's giving this committee inflict with other mandate, let's discuss it.
Okay.
I think I'm open for that kind of discussion,
okay,
rather than trying to slap it down and say, look, you are wrong, and you don't have a right to talk.
Okay. And Madam Charlotte also talks about the fact that some political parties had taken entrenched positions on national matters, and it wasn't healthy for the nation, and definitely not the way to go. And then she puts a question that, are we going to continue to politicize everything in this country? Why do we do this to ourselves? Why do we do this to this nation? That sounds like a commissioner who is frustrated and is pouring her heart out. How do you take her posturing?
Well, good morning to your cherished viewers. For me, I don't think Madam is frustrated. She's actually hitting the nail right on the head,
sure,
as to what we need to do, what is happening, so that the entire population will know exactly what is happening. Currently, as we see now, you realize that the timetable they gave to political parties have been readjusted. And it's as a result of some of these things that is ongoing, because there are a lot of distractions. And therefore, we are creating a very difficult situation for the EC. But for me, she's a very strong woman. She's actually exhibited that competence and that zeal to ensure that the right things are done. The Electoral Commission is an independent body. Yes, political parties, I've always said, have interests. And every political party, especially those that are in very high contention for the presidential seat, will do all what it takes to ensure that their issues are accepted.
Sure.
But the EC is an independent body. They have rules and regulations. And therefore, for me, they should stick to the principles, ensure that the right things that has to be done should be done. Because if they are to follow all the things that the political parties want to do, mm-hmm, I'm sure come November 7th, we'll not have elections in Ghana.
Okay. All right, then. Prof, I want you to have the second point here, and then I'll come to NAPO. So, I mean, with this going on, I mean, the criticism and all of it, it's also supposed to make the EC better. It is really supposed to reduce whether it's tension. It is also to make the parties accept whatever the outcome of election 2016 would be.
Yes, certainly yes. I think these are getting ready for the big show in November. Okay, and there are going to be issues. And as a nation, we have a right to discuss those issues.
Sure.
Okay? The political parties have made a pitch. They say we don't like this. The EC came out and explained why this committee was set up and why we're doing what we're doing. For me, this is healthy. Mm-hmm. Let's continue with this debate. But I think I do agree with the EC chairperson.
Okay.
We must do this within some constraints. We must bring out the real issues.
Okay,
we understand that we are in election year. Some political party would like to drag things a little bit down their way. But at the end of the day, we got to make sure that we get an election and
sure,
a credible elections. And we'll do all these preparations. I don't think the EC is going to get it right all the time.
Okay, all
okay?
right.
Okay, so for me, let's debate this, let's discuss this, and let's make sure that we bring out the issues.
Sure.
Yeah, on the issue of the steering committee.
Sure.
For me, my worry is the fact that we don't know the terms of reference, because I believe that
it's for information sharing.
There should be a terms of reference, and this should be known to the general public.
Okay.
I don't know what is happening in terms of the public relations aspect of the EC.
Okay.
Well, these are not issues that political parties have to debate over,
okay,
as to what the commission, what the committee is about.
Okay.
There should be clear guidelines.
Okay.
And any person who takes a newspaper should know the functions of the steering committee.
Okay.
So they need to look at.
Okay. So Madame Chalasete was asked why the political parties or IPAC was not informed about the committee. And she says, well, it's not an oversight body of the EC, but an important stakeholder from that helps to assist the EC. So they really weren't mandated to tell, they are not supposed to tell the IPAC that, you know, today we're doing this or tomorrow we're doing that. So they can do it whether you know it or not.
Really? So why the brother?
No,
if you see, I don't want to be critical of this body. So why
not?
If the EC claims it can do what it likes because the constitution, Article 46 or something, is all the power to not to be exercise independence and everything. Why? So what the fuss? Somebody will ask. Because you just can't do that because, by virtue of what you are doing, your function. EC is not the NCC, right? That when they even get it wrong, it has of no consequence, right? The main job of the EC is neutrality, transparency, probity, accountability, and audit trail. Those are the key ingredients that will make the EC work successful.
And that is augmented
from the relationship. And that is why the forum called IPAC is not only political parties. There are even civil society organizations with interest in elections. Our development partners sit around the table. They are all there, making sure that, well, not anybody cannot get its way, but this is the way this whole country wants to move. Right? I'll just give an example. Put the election steering committee aside. The EC is the one that came with an election timetable for the year. It is not the political parties that decided what they want. Right? So if you come with an election, this is the election year, timetable, and say, March, we are going to do registration. Right? Because this is not the first election they are doing, you know.
Absolutely.
They have been doing it since 1992. So when people like Asiedu Ketia and Mark Benu and things sitting around the table, Bernard Mona, Kabila, they are dons. They've worked with everybody. So they can smell something coming. So if you put your own commission committee around, and you had all this election advisory body. Why couldn't other commission members who were at IPAC communicate that to the thing? Like my colleague said, it should be transparent. Even if you had come up with a circular, said EC has formed this committee and this is their job, A, B, C, D, E. Not everybody might like it, but they will know that you are being transparent. But this is something that you did before the IPAC meeting, and the members of your commission could not go and articulate why the committee had been formed. That is why Rekubube.
Yes, I'm even coming to the critical.
Keen supporters of Madame Charlotte are saying.
Yes.
It's for the first time coming out to say that the whole process lacks transparency and integrity.
Okay.
So they should go back to work. What I'm trying to say is that even this registration that has been postponed to May, the issue surrounding it is critical. Because are we going forward as a country or are we coming back? Something that just 2014, we did limited registration in every electoral area. From 2012, we've come to 2014. And we are going on to 2016. And we are going to combine electoral areas and do tot-tot limited registration. We have forgotten that what happened in 2010. So we need to move on. The commission, if you have challenges, let us know.
Okay, all right. So that takes me to the opinion piece by Dr. Charles Rekubube, former boss of the VRA. And the title is interesting. It says, what's in a name? Everything, if it has to do with election 2016. It says, what's in a name? Everything. And he took time to explain, you know, the steering committee, which he picked and says that, you know, that the committee decides, you know, on the priorities or order of business of organization, manages the general course of its operations. But in this steering committee by the Madame Charlotte, so she says it's just for information sharing. But these are some things that he's asking. He says that they should, EC must go back to square one, scrap the steering committee, establish an election implementation advisory committee, which will bring together all the statutory bodies and expected to play roles that would assist the EC to carry out a successful election. And to state without ambiguity that overt membership or active participation in politics automatically. It sounds like a good suggestion.
I'm telling you. You see, this whole hullabaloo would not have happened if other members of the commission had bought into Madame Charlotte Osei's thing. I can say confidently that we are where we are because the commission members decided to brief against the position of the EC chair.
Okay.
And if you cannot carry along your immediate commission members, you are still, you see, the political parties are smart. They will create drives and wedges where there is none. So if by your actions it brings it, they will shout. So that's what I'm saying. It is very difficult to get all the four political parties or five political parties around IPAC to agree. It's happened only about few times. Okay. But the EC has conducted elections so many times. So please, at least, bring along your commission members and be transparent and explain your position to everybody. Okay. And we'll move on.
Prof, the suggestion by Dr. Charles Rekubebe, you know, scrap the steering committee. One, are you for that? Will that change anything?
Well, I would know that. We just said that we are not clear on the functions or the terms of reference of the committee.
Oh, but she just said that it's for decisions, what is it called, an information sharing platform.
Very good. You can form a committee for anything you want. She said the committee she has in mind is just for information sharing. It's not even advisory. These are two separate things.
Sure.
You can have a committee to advise you, experts who advise your organization to do A, B, C, D, given this situation, X, Y, Z.
Sure.
That is not the committee she says she wants to set up. I say, I want to set up a committee. That is what she said. I go back what the person said. I want a committee that will share information. What are we doing here? We are sharing information with the public.
Sure.
You are not advising the public. Okay, now what group of brace suggestion is a different thing altogether. These are two separate things.
Mm.
So let the EC.
But it is based on the conversation that has gone on.
No.
It is based on the concerns that have been raised by parties, important stakeholders.
Now, so are we therefore saying that yes, what group of brace say yes, let's form a committee, but the committee must do A, B, C. That is his argument. The EC said yes, let's form a committee. But we want the committee we have in mind. We are the one running this organization. We know where we have some shortfalls. We know where we need to augment. We want a committee to share information.
Okay.
If we want an advisory committee, we have that too. So,
why should that decision be taken?
Well, let me land on this.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not confuse the two issues.
Okay.
You can say that what the EC is proposing, an information sharing committee, should be scrapped and replaced with, is what group members saying, advisory?
Advisory very good. Committee.
These are big apples and oranges.
Yeah. Election implementation very advisory
good.
Committee.
Very good. Election implementation advisory committee.
That's even bigger than that.
That is a big deal. Is it? So let's not jump to that yet.
Okay.
It's a big deal. It's very, very different from what the EC chairperson is saying. I don't want an advisory committee. If she wants one, let her create one and tell us. Give us a terms of reference.
What is IPAC?
Well,
it's a party advisory committee.
Very good. You see, we need to be careful about this.
All right.
She said, this is the scope of what I want to do.
Okay.
You look at it. If you like it, let me know. If you don't like it, let's discuss it.
Okay.
But I'm quite clear. She said, information sharing.
Okay.
No advisory.
All right. Prof, how about this point where she says, to state without ambiguity, that overt membership or active participation in politics automatically disbars anybody from membership of the advisory committee. I mean, given the challenge that the steering committee has had with some members who were found to have been active members of political parties.
Yes, even that too, I don't agree, but that's my opinion.
Okay, go ahead.
If it's just an information sharing group,
then it doesn't matter if you're colored.
Well, it doesn't really. You see, if we're not careful,
mm-hmm.
if we're not careful in this country, we'll bar some people from doing a lot of things in this country. We got to be careful.
Okay, makes sense.
The man may be an MPP or NDC or PPP, but it can still be useful for us on ABC. The good thing is that we know his color, so we are watching him like a hawk. If his opinion is slanted towards where we know he came from, we can say, guy, we know you, you know. You know you're from this party. What you're saying is more like, I mean projecting that party in this committee.
But
I don't think we must say that we disqualify people from some committees which which we think we can be, get some usefulness for that person.
Okay.
But that is just my opinion.
But Prof, we keep saying 1992 till now. Okay, so Ghana is running a fledgling democracy. Are people mature enough to take that advice that you're giving? Okay, yes, he's colored, but yes, he still can't do the job without, you know, any conflicts of interest. Are people really mature?
It all depends. What do you mean? We're the ordinary people.
Yeah. The
political parties are a different lot. Okay. We're the ordinary people too. We are a different lot.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm not sure about that.
Well, let me qualify that.
Sure.
The political parties, the members of the political parties are in active business, active service. They have to protect their interest. That is fair. That is what they're in there for, to propagate their issues, to follow it up, get elected, and act on it. So anything that goes against that, they are bound to fight it. The ordinary people, we are sitting down there and we are told. Now the question is this: are we mature enough? That is a very strong word. Whether we are mature enough to accept a situation where people from other parties can get in. I'm not sure, but we must be mindful. There are some countries in this world where people, when you are elected, they bring people from the other parties to join them on special committees on a national basis.
Okay.
Okay, some even appoint. Look at Obama's cabinet. There are people from the Republican Party who he appointed. Okay, because he knows where they're coming from. The only thing I'm saying is that it's very important for us not to exclude people because they belong to a particular party. Or else, the danger for that is that even if the person doesn't belong to that party, you will call him and say, oh, although he didn't declare that he's a part of that party, so-and-so say he's a member of that party, so let's exclude him. That person might be very useful for us.
Okay.
So I think it's very important for us to be very careful. I'm not saying that people should agree with me, but I think that a membership of a party should not exclude somebody from a particular committee if he's not going to project the image, the views of that party in that committee. Certainly, let them run.
All right. Tessa, I want to pick your thoughts as well on the, you know, what's in the name. Everything, if it's about election 2016, you know, sort of suggestions by Dr. Charles Rukurubi that, you know, well, let's go back to square one. Probably scrap it, probably get an advisory committee, and also make clear, you know, who gets to serve on it, who qualifies to even serve on it, and if whether their party...
First of all, I don't believe that the Electoral Commission went to all the organizations that have come together to form the steering committee to pinpoint those individuals that they wanted to form that steering committee. They wrote to the various institutions for them to nominate one single individual to be part of the committee. And that is, for me, is very fair. As to what terms of reference...
It's just that the chairman of the Peace Council comes out and says what he says, cast it down. That's why she's...
Okay.
But I agree with you.
Yeah.
They wrote...
Exactly. Whether there was a term of reference as to the sort of people they want to be on that committee, we are yet to be told.
Okay.
For me, I believe that it should be part. It should have been part of the letter, because since it is a commission, anybody who comes on it, the person is looked at in all angles.
Sure.
But you see, as a country, there is something that we are getting it very, very wrong. We are taking our party coloration as the benchmark for everything we do in this country. We are not looking at competence of the individual. Because for me, whether the person is a sympathizer of the NDC or the MPP, you look at whether the person is very fair, whether the person is very transparent, and whether the person has that competency so that his coming onto that steering committee will reflect positively in enhancing our democracy. And that should be it, okay? But we are in a country where anything that comes up, the first thing we look at is whether the person is MPP or NDC. And the moment you see the person, maybe, oh, this man at the time I was talking about NDC, he never responded positively. So he's an MPP. And so therefore, it should be up. No. When we do that, look, the human resources that we need to enhance this country of ours, we will never get them.
Okay.
We will never get there.
All right.
To act in public service.
Okay. So just, you know, quick one before we move on. I mean, we'll go to the court issue as well. But where she talks about the fact that, you know, they wrote to the Peace Council, right? The Peace Council actually responded. And she was actually stunned that the Peace Council said they didn't, because she received acknowledgement from the Peace Council. Yeah, yeah, and that if the Peace Council continues on this, it would create, quote, credibility problems for all of us. That's what she said here.
I just wish this has just happened to have come out.
Sure.
That's why Prof. Might have said that her frustration, she's pouring out her frustration. The words she's used in connection with Peace Council is just a bit overboard.
But if Peace Council talks, wait.
It is not an ordinary person of the Peace Council. And the man hasn't spoken once. Yesterday, for the first time, I went to do some work in the evening. I was flipping channels and I heard, oh, we have the chairman of the Peace Council on.
Sure.
What did he say? He said, as the council, no letter that he chairs has come to the council. Letters that come to the council are received by the executive secretary.
Sure.
So it is most likely, that's what he said, that executive secretory or somebody received, the administration received the council letter and probably had written to EC. Because as a council, it has never come to any of their meetings. And they haven't
But they haven't been fair. The secretariat hasn't been fair then.
I'm coming. They haven't been cited. They haven't had sight of any of such letter. Just yesterday, he's come out again. So before you grant such an interview and say such things, he said it last week. So a call to him would have resolved that issue.
Yeah.
And I sincerely think the chair calling the chairman of the council, because the Peace Council is a critical component of the stakeholders in this election year. If the Peace Council chairman is saying, oh, our representative that came, it was not nominated by us, take it in good faith. Call the guy, who somebody signed the letter. Oh, chair, this person signed the letter bringing this nominee. If it is not from the council, we are very, very sorry. But then deal with your internal matters and get back to us. When you come and pour your frustration that if Peace Council continues on this path, it will lead us all into problems, you are now shifting the blame onto the Peace Council chairman, right? How are you going to work with a person after that, right? Maybe the chairman has said what is true, because yesterday he came back again insisting. So a telephone call does a lot of things. Or visiting the chairman or asking for a meeting with the chairman would have resolved this issue instead of making it public. Now, from this, I don't know where...
Because he would read it. I mean, everybody would read
it. It's too harsh.
Prof, what do you... Because she says that, you know, obviously, if the National Peace Council says that they didn't nominate the person, it cast great doubts on it. And like she said, it creates credibility problems for all of us. By that, I'm sure for the EC as well.
I think I made a point earlier.
Sure.
That the tone of the interview...
was a bit harsh?
Well, it shows that there is a little bit of anxiety. Probably frustration is not a strong word, but it's quite clear. You don't need to be an expert to know that she felt that there are a lot of things which are not going right. But I agree with my colleague on that, Doc on that. I don't know. I will be very surprised if she didn't, or if her team didn't check on that. Okay, the chairperson of the Peace Council said, we didn't know about this. Is that correct? I think this thing can be sorted out. I mean, now that the Peace Council chair also came and said his version, I think they will sort it out somehow.
Okay.
But what she said is a little bit strong that if they go on, I think it's in the tone of everything that she's saying.
Sure.
That, look, guys, we got to be careful. We cannot go on this road. I think let's take her word for it. Let's give her the support. We are not home yet. We are just at the beginning. And I really think that if we want to get must listen to each other.
Okay.
Yes.
Quick one at a time. Now, who wants to see draft report of a voters register?
And this issue about the Peace Council and then the EC, I will not for the EC that much, in a sense that institutions have the way they operate. There's a secretariat. And when I want to send a correspondence, definitely the letter goes to the secretariat, okay? It is up to the secretariat to then direct the letter that they've received to the recipient, the one that the letter has been addressed to, okay? Now, per what we are being told, letters were received, acknowledgement
came in. She said, yes.
Okay? Now, if members of the council say that they were not aware, then it means the problem is coming from their end. It means there is a problem with
But Doc makes the point that she could have also gone out of her way.
No, you hold on.
Okay.
Now, what they, after hearing the news, if it were to be me, the first thing I would have done was to consult my secretariat. Did you receive a letter? Yes, we did receive a letter. Whom was that letter addressed to? To the chairman of the council.
And who Why didn't appointed you? The exactly. person on to the
Exactly.
committee?
Why didn't you give the letter to me? Who appointed the nominee?
Yeah.
Who gave the clearance? Sure. You know, these are, so you go, you do that background check before you come, and then you also respond.
Okay.
So, for me, the Peace Council also did not communicate effectively.
The Executive Secretary of Peace Council has not acted fairly.
Sure, to the council and East.
Exactly.
All right. So we're moving on to the Finder newspaper. I mean, the story is actually captured in the Daily Guide, Daily Graphic, and the Finder newspaper that EC dragged to court.
Today is easy.
It's the most important one. We'll get to Baumia. We will.
No. I mean, I'm not talking about what about Baumia. I'm just saying that
it
is very good that we are discussing EC. There are a lot of things that we have to talk about to help to election 2016.
All right, then. So this
but
one
it is not true that the parties don't always agree. It's very important.
We
agree 90% of the time.
Yeah.
Great. Well, the person is a legal practitioner, Mr. Kwame Boafo, has filed a suit asking the Supreme Court to declare the current National Voters Register compiled by the Electoral Commission and intended to be used for the 2016 general elections in Ghana bloated and hence unfit for use in the 2016 general elections. We'll get to the reliefs a bit, but Prof, we are in February, okay, so just a few days to end. We'll go to March, elections in November. Mm-hmm. The person, I mean, clearly exercising his right, but what do you see happening here?
Well, I think we've gone that
line.
We've gone through this before.
Okay.
And I'm a bit confused where we are.
Okay.
If we are still talking about the bloatedness of the register, I made a point before. For me, these are issues of numbers. It's easy to establish. Using technology, we can easily figure this thing out. If it's bloated, we fix it. Okay? If it's bloated in one session, we fix that. I remember using these terms before. Now, the EC is dragged to court. You're correct. We are now in what? Almost in March. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I don't know. If the court come and say, well, it is the register is bloated and we must do something about it, are we still going to have election in November? Is it possible? I will not want to prejudge what the court is going to come up with. But this has been long running for a while.
But what does this do now? I mean, the timing of it to the whole atmosphere, the whole general elections as well.
And well, certainly.
Course, even further pressure on the Electoral Commission.
Well, certainly, this matter is not going away. I wish it goes away like rain, so that we have a dry day and move on. Very good. This matter is not going away. But the sad thing about it is that we are not getting to the crux of the issue.
Which is?
Now, if the register is bloated, do we have the evidence? If we have the evidence and it's clearly stated that it's bloated, is it feasible before November?
Sure.
If the answer is yes, let's fix it.
Sure.
If the evidence shows that it's not bloated, and we all agree that it's not bloated, that is the end of the matter.
But it's where I sit now, I mean, parties, we all agree. They actually agree that it's bloated, yes.
We all agree that it's bloated.
Yes.
Good. To what extent is it bloated? Does it mean that we have to compile a whole national new register, or the areas that we have identified as bloated, can we fix it? Okay? Rather than overhauling the whole system. That's the next question. Okay? We need a clear answer to that.
Okay.
Okay, since we answered the first question. And then, if that is even the, if you say it's not the whole country, it's just some area we have targeted, and those, can we fix it before November? Will it delay? I think these are clear issues, clear questions, which we must ask, and then do it. But the way it's going, some people going to court, it's their right to go to court, but at the end of the day, we're not tackling the real issues that will take us home. That means home for me is November 7th to have the election. If you're not careful, this issue can drag on, we will think it's a joke. Okay? The day before the election, people say, guys, we have not sorted out this issue. If you go ahead with the elections, we will challenge it.
Okay.
Because you remember, we'll be talking about this for so many months. So for me, that is my biggest worry. This matter must be put to rest one way or the other, with facts, with figures, with clear answers, not hearsays, expectations, or perceptions.
Okay.
For me, we are not there yet. We still at the beginning of something, and we are getting a bit too late.
Okay.
For this.
As
for our registers, the truth of the matter is that it will always be bloated. And Honorable Napo knows what I'm talking about. Bloating of register, who does it? It's with the connivance of the political parties. It is not the ordinary citizen that goes to, sometimes maybe not within the age, and then goes to register. It's with the connivance of the same political parties. Okay? I've always said that, look, re-registration is a wasted effort. We are just going to waste resources.
Okay.
If you look at the laws of the Electoral Commission in terms of registration, if you want to take out names from the register, there are clear guidelines as to what to do. If any serious political party wants to ensure that people that the political party claims are not qualified to be in the register, if there is any serious political party in this country that wants to expunge those names from the register, there are clear guidelines. You need no new register in order to do that. And we know. So what is the first of telling Ghanaians that the register is bloated as if there's nothing that can be done about it? We know the processes that we can initiate to clear those things out of the register. And I don't know why we don't want to do that. And we create the impression that the register was bloated maybe by angels.
Angels don't bloat it.
Exactly. Okay. So please, whichever political party has certain names that it feels that those names are not supposed to be on the register, we know what to do, and we should do that.
Okay. Is the NPP doing what they are supposed to do to get the names out of the register, whether it's double registration, triple registration, minors on the register?
I like to continue from where my two colleagues are. Sure. A very, very interesting discussions from Prof. It is not going away. We should bring it to a finality so that we can have a good run. Very, very poignant statement. We know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just do it.
Okay.
So what is the problem? What is the problem? You see, it is not him as a political party or me as a political party or him as an active citizen whose job it is to clean the register. After all, we've just been told that the EC is independent and we should allow them to do their work. So it's not Tetechai's comment or Prof's comment that will solve the problem. It's EC that has to solve the problem. EC didn't feel that there was even bloatedness because they didn't even think about compiling a new register was important. I, multiple people, don't think we need a new register.
Okay.
In the sense that we've gone past that issue. Because the whole committee was set up, right? Five eminent people, a retired Supreme Court judge, a retired EC boss, a retired
statistician,
a world-renowned computer expert. I don't know the fifth one, a member of the Peace Council.
Council, yeah.
The one that we are fighting.
Sure.
Five, right? It's interesting to read their report of what they felt. One of the conclusions is that we don't need a new register.
That's period. Critical.
It was even on EC's website.
Really?
Yes. Yes. I went to EC.
I went there.
It was there. So we have copies. All the political parties have copies. Page 19 of the report. Page 19 of the report says that the current register is bloated.
Okay.
19. Clear statement. The current, and it is not fit for purpose for 2016 election. Those are the five eminent people. I'm not talking. But what do they say? We don't need to go through the new register because, as Tete Che, my brother Tete just said, it will lead to the same bloatedness.
Exactly.
But what do they say? When elections have been won by less than 5% margin in this country, there are over 600,000 people dead from their statistical analysis on the register. And we need to expunge them, apart from foreigners or something. They don't end there. They said that we cannot use the already known processes that Ghana has in cleaning the register to clean, because it will not work. The EC's commentary on the report is that our systems don't work, so the normal challenges and objections and things cannot clean the register. The committee doesn't end there. It says that, oh, to cure this problem of bloatedness that me and Tete, we contribute. Let's accept that,
sure,
we contribute,
get
because we are encouraging our people to. What do we do? The committee says that the register should be opened, and every Ghanaian who wants to remain, who is on the register, apart from the limited registration to avail, everybody who wants to remain on the register should go and affirm. So when you go and you affirm, dead people can't go and affirm. Because for the first time in the history of this country, we've taken fingerprints and pictures. It's already there. And we have, look, we did the district level elections, right? We compile the register, you go. So you go, your picture is in, we take it, it's you. And then, if you don't turn up, then we can expunge you from the register. But we need to create, a specific law. So that's why we said they even went ahead. I said, it's not me. It's a retired chairman of the EC, a retired Supreme Court judge, one of the most notable Ghanaians who've written all our laws, statistician. So I was expecting the EC to convene an IPAC around who set up the committee. We think EC hasn't got the power. But nobody challenged the EC when they set up a five-member committee. So this is your committee's report. These are the recommendations. We are not going for a new register. But how can we together, this is what the experts say we should clean our register. Can we do it? Can't we do it? Oh, we can modify this one here. We can do this way. EC, sit down together with IPAC.
Engage IPAC post the committee.
And this issue about people going to court and things, it's a dangerous, because you never know the outcome of a court case. You never know. I cannot sit here and tell you that.
So if the court, for instance, decides that we get the names and we open it for Ghanaians to come in.
If you read, somebody is going to court and say that EC issue and go by and enforce what his own committee is recommending to EC.
Sure, that's what
So if the Supreme Court, in the 2013 judgment, one of the things that was clear was that the register, something should be done about the register. So if the Supreme Court sits, I'm not saying that is what the outcome is going to be, and says that, you EC, this is what your own committee of experts are saying. If you don't even agree with your committee of experts, you have taken some and agreed to some.
Sure.
One of the things they said you agree with is no new register, right? So the others, why aren't you engaging the stakeholders? That yes, the committee said this, but we can't do everything. So how could we balance? That is what I suspect, will bring a finality to this. But just letting it lie would not bring a finality. That prof wants, or that teacher, me and teacher, I want. It's not about MPP, it's not about NDC. As you, as an EC, if you set up a committee to advise you, a committee of experts to advise you, and they advise you, and you are not taking it, come out to the political parties and let's look the way forward.
Opening the register, for instance, and say if you want to vote in 2016 election, come and affirm, and people don't turn up. I mean, then a lot of people will also be disenfranchised.
Yes,
They answer that question in there.
Yes, you
did. What did
yes,
you say?
They answer it in there.
Okay. Let's hear it.
They answer them.
What did you say?
You first, they claim one first, you need a legal regime. Yeah. Yes. They don't say, go ahead and do it. Yeah. Yes. They come and take the pass. Yeah. Registering to vote, the right is to be allowed to register. Yeah. But it's not compulsory that you go and register.
Yes.
So if the EC says, you're not doing a new register, everybody who wants to be on the register, come and affirm. And the Parliament of Ghana brings laws to that effect. They haven't done anything wrong.
Okay, but they haven't done that.
Very no, they haven't.
Yes, they haven't done that.
Let's see. I have not read the committee's report, but I'm taking from Doc's narrative. They said, well, we cannot compile a new register. Is that what I'm getting?
Yes.
No, because we haven't resolved.
There are some few things we need to fix.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And then the first thing, they propose some of the ways that it can be done.
Mm-hmm.
One of the ways is that we open a register, we all show up and say, oh, that's me. Then mm-hmm. we take you. If you don't show up, then you're gone.
Mm-hmm.
That's dangerous. Law or no law?
Yeah.
Sure.
Damn dangerous. I know two members of that committee very well. Okay? It's very interesting. That's the point I made even earlier. Okay? Nick Quino was said that he's an NDC guy. Mm-hmm. The Peace Council man is an NDC guy. Now they came up with a report. We all think that it's a great report.
Oh, that's
okay?
That's an interesting
very
point.
Good. I know some of these guys very well. Is that correct? So when they were complaining, I said, look, here we go again. The guys are experts.
Sure.
Okay? Never mind their political correlation. Now we are just saying that they are eminent. Well, no, there were a lot of hula balu about that. He's not the one. Let me come up to the point. Five eminent people.
Sure.
But they don't have the monopoly of knowledge. Okay? The time that they were giving was also very short.
Sure.
In fact, when they were giving a brief, I said, well, I'm glad I'm not part of this. This is a tough call.
Sure.
It doesn't matter which way you go, you will still be blamed. Okay? But the proposal that came out, if what Doc is saying is the case, we open the register. One of the processes to fix the problem. I'm not saying that they are wrong. I'm just saying that the practicability of it and the outcome, when you propose a process, you want to see what the outcome will be. If you don't show up, how long are they going to open that register? 1 week? 2 weeks? 3 months? Remember?
I've done it before.
Well, I know that. But what they are saying now is that if you don't show up, then you are out. Is that correct? There may be a reason why a lot of people don't show up. Okay? There may be a lot of reasons why people don't show up.
Sure.
Remember this issue of the ghost register. Okay? They did a lot of those things. And look, if you are still...
If we are doing a new national register, you don't show up, what happens?
Well, that one, your name will not be on the register.
Yes, but no. let's get this point. You see, so the point I'm making is that I'm not saying... They are great people,
sure.
But they
Prof,
don't have...
Prof, I'll plead with you.
Yes, sir.
That the laws in the country
yes.
allows for continuous registration.
Yes.
Even today, yeah. If you have good reasons while your name is not on register, you walk to EC, mm-hmm. The laws allow you to be registered.
Yes.
It is not a finality of what they said. That is whatever they've said,
yes.
Engage the stakeholders and come out with reasons why even the recommendation might not work.
Very good.
That's all I said.
That's what we're discussing.
But
that's fantastic.
If they are not doing that, people yes. go to court unnecessarily.
I totally agree with you. The point I'm making is that we are discussing some of their recommendations.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
They didn't say that this our recommendation is casting iron on the stone. You must do it. They are recommendations. They are advisory. The EC will take on board, talk to the stakeholders.
The ones they like.
No.
The
report will be looked at by another group of people. Say, look, this is what these people first, we agree that the register is bloated. We agree that we cannot do overall new registration.
Sure.
This is what they expect. Do we agree to that? Yes, we agree. What did they propose? Oh, there are some problems we need to face. Did they propose a way we can face it? Yes. Are those workable within the time limit?
Yes.
Within the time limit that we got.
Okay.
Is that correct? Because if what they are proposing requires a lot of national awareness campaign, okay, radio announcement, a lot of things we need to do to tell people this is what we are going to do. Oh, fantastic. Eminent people, what they propose is not doable within this time period. Probably, can we do something else? We have brilliant people.
We
have brilliant people in this country. Brilliant people in this country, not outside this country, who can look at this report and see how we can operationalize some part of it. The part that we say is good, but we will not implement it, we'll give the reason why we will not do it. Okay, they don't say that we should adopt it. So personally, I think we are getting there, okay, little by little, but I'm getting a bit worried. Time is catching up.
Sure.
Some of the proposals, some of the processes they wanted to go to fix the problem must start yesterday. Otherwise, we will not be able to do it. And the danger is this. This report now is not in public domain.
They put it on their
website. Is that in public domain?
Yeah, is there
very
now?
Good. The people who were opposing the committee, now? The people who were approving the committee were now saying, now we got a report. Let's discuss it. EC must show that they are going to do something about this report. Very quickly. Or else, they will open a Pandora box. We got a committee report and nothing is happening. But I must say, what is recommended by the committee is not necessarily casting iron on stone.
Sure.
We will look at it and see whether they are practical within a time frame. At the end of the day, will they get it to November 7th for election? Okay. If this one will not do, we can postpone for next time. But let's get a consensus before we get to election. Or else, we'll have a situation that people will say, you see the own committee, as the doctor is saying, the committee you set up, say ABCD, you didn't do it. Now that we have election, we are going to challenge it. That is the danger.
But who said November 7th, Prof?
Well, you said November.
I got it from him. Have you seen anything? It's a proposal.
I'm sorry.
Very, very interesting.
Okay, don't November. Go to the November.
It's December.
I'm sorry. I will not go to your head.
As we draw closer, like Prof is saying, it's very. People get nervous. Because now somebody is going to court, and like Napo makes a point that, of course, you don't know the outcome of court cases like that. And I mean, I've seen the reports now, and it says that there is some, and the analysis says you said it's bloated.
Page 19.
Page 19. I went to page. It says there is some. Okay, so page 9. I'll get to page 19.
I'll open it for you while you talk.
For you in particular, what concerns you the most, especially as the case goes to court, and of course they will have to file their defense, but what concerns you the most about
court issues? It is good a citizenry exercising their democratic right. For me, my worry is that, as Napo rightly said, that he knows that that issue has been dealt with. It's over.
Sure.
But it is the National Youth Organizer of the MPP who has once again sent this thing to court.
Because the MPP is still dissatisfied.
Exactly. Which means Napo is even not aware that his own party is not.
He's aware.
Napo, this is your. Youth organizer.
He's acting as a citizen who is not without knowledge.
Oh, okay.
Compelling EC to follow their own.
But you see, for me, if there are no processes that can be used to ensure that the register is clean, then I would have also had a very big problem. Okay, but the register as it is, the rules and regulations as we have now, has inbuilt mechanisms that any political party at the police station level can use to correct the system.
Sure.
And I think the political parties
help.
need to focus on that, because for me, if within a police station within my locality, there is a name that person is not qualified, when the limited registration is open, I will go and then challenge that.
But who does that?
Okay.
Who does that?
Who does what?
Who does what you are saying?
It is incumbent upon us.
So, but you have to go and report.
Exactly.
So the person won't turn up.
If the person doesn't turn up, what happens is that the name is deleted automatically.
That's what I'm saying.
Because when I raise an issue, you also have to turn up.
Yes.
Okay.
You don't turn up.
But if you don't turn up,
you are gone.
Then you are gone. So why are we fighting?
We shouldn't fight.
The processes are there.
Give the power to the EC to effect what you are talking about. Simple.
All right. So let's move on now to some other stories now. And
the EC should engage the IPAC in the way ahead. Simple.
Right. After the engagement,
so, it's very simple.
And they should open up more.
So yesterday, Dr. Mahmoud Bawumia, was in the news for. He spoke at a forum.
We haven't
and,
read it.
You haven't read it. I mean, I read it yesterday, but a number of them. You have. It's all over. It says, tell us project cost. Bahumia. Yes, tell us project cost. Bahumia, vice presidential candidate, New Patriotic Party, the Muhammad-led NDC government is hiding the real cost of the project it's embarking on. Now, if you sum the cost of all the loans financed projects listed in the Green Book, including those with artistic impressions, like that, it is less than $7 billion. Meanwhile, the government has borrowed the equivalent of $37 billion. But how do you zoom? How does, I mean, when these, I mean, he's a former deputy governor of the bank, I mean, economist and all of the world. But from where he said, can he tell those things? Prof, I'm asking you. Napo will have the
What is
second
the
word and then.
I don't, I don't know the story, and you want me to talk about the issue behind the story. What is the story? Okay. What is he on about?
He's asking the NDC government to tell them the cost about the projects that they claim they have done. I mean, roads, road construction, because government has borrowed some $37 billion.
Yeah.
And that when you sum up the project, it's just around $7 billion. That's just what, that's the story.
And he wants what?
He wants the government to tell them the cost. Is it $37 billion? It doesn't, he's just trying to say that the cost of it does not balance. If you look at the balance sheet, what they have done and what they have borrowed, it's a par.
Well, he is a,
it's parallel.
He's a vice presidential candidate. Is that correct? I think he has a right to ask for those things.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, he has a right. He wants the cost of things. Is that correct? He should know where to get those things.
Okay.
He should know.
Okay.
Exactly. Okay. Another Ministry of Finance. I think he as a vice presidential candidate, he's a big man.
So he's just...
I cannot walk to the Ministry of Finance and say, look, let me get a cost of this thing.
That is
say,
the problem, if you can't.
I cannot. No. Let's take a reason. I am just an ordinary citizen. Look, I don't go. You don't go to the Ministry of Finance and say, I want this information. They say, well, you first go to the website.
Sure.
What we want to put on the website is there. Go and read it. Okay? Dr. Bahumia could actually get some few research assistants.
Sure.
First, go on the internet, comb the government records, and get some of this cost. And if he's not happy, you go to the Minister of Finance and say, look, I'm the vice presidential candidate of the largest opposition party in this country. Okay? And former deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana, for that matter. Can I get this cost? Because you say, where do you want it? I say, want it. Let me tell you, remember, when Rawlings was in party, was the president, he made a statement. That time Kufuor was campaigning. Kufuor went to, I think, the World Bank or the IMF in Washington and asked for information.
Sure.
Is that correct? Rawlings was the one saying this. Asked for information on some of the...
It is not true.
Well, never mind. Okay. You can say the former master. Let me finish my...
Call Kufuor. Have you called Kufuor?
No. Listen. Listen.
Rawlings is lying.
Okay. This is what he said. I'm just quoting him.
Yes.
It's not gospel.
I remember that very carefully. Rawlings said that... Do you know one guy went to World Bank and asking them for information on some loans and this thing, and they told him more or less to go to hell.
Okay.
You can get that information from his country.
Okay.
Is that correct? And later on they say it's Kufuor. Is that correct? Every party who is seeking election to run this country, especially the senior officer, principal officers, have a right to get information. If Bahumia want information on these things, I think he can get it.
Okay,
you don't need to come and tell us that this thing. Now, what would he do with that information? He said, I want to compare things and see whether it makes sense. So I don't see anything wrong with what he's asking for. But I really think if he have his own research team, I think he can get this information.
You have a minute and a half and then we'll wrap up. Dr. Bahumia, I mean, basically asking for, you know, cost of projects and
Prof,
just reechoing the
I want to start from where Prof is saying that if Bahumia puts together some research assistant and gets and can't get the information, he can walk to the Ministry of Finance.
Especially
with his background as a former deputy governor. I read the story. Bridget, if you wouldn't let us read the story, you will get Prof to go on a tangent till he's gone. When the story does not bear out like that. But don't do that. Read the story. What did Baumia say?
But I have read it.
No! From what Prof said, if you read the story.
Yes.
If you read the story, Baumia said the total cost, the total cost of the sum of the total cost of the
project. You've read the story.
That's what I just said.
Yeah, it's there. You claim you didn't. No, you've not read it.
She read it. She read it. But Prof didn't hear it.
Did she read it?
Let you listen carefully.
Okay, go ahead.
Prof's whole statement is premised on the fact that Baumia should put research assistants together. And if she can't get the information, since he's asking for cost.
So he didn't get the question.
But your statement was that Baumia had said the sum of the projects that they listed in their book and given prices, and given cost adds up to 7 billion. That is a mistake. In the Green Book, the cost of those projects, when you add it up and all that, my brother, if I should give you my space, give it to you.
30 seconds.
It's 7 billion. They are all listed cost. Meanwhile, they've borrowed 30 what?
37.
You see, 37 hospitals. They borrowed, money. Wait. Yeah. That is the government of Baumia's statement.
Okay.
It is not something discussion. Okay. He's saying that you've borrowed, you have told us you've borrowed 37 billion. Your listed projects you've listed
is 7 billion.
That's the kind of way.
Thank you very much.
In the first place, the Green Book doesn't contain all the developmental projects. That government is
you are bringing part two.
No, you can't put everything into that document. Okay, you can't put everything. Into
only 7 billion out of 37.
But you see, if Baumia wants to know the total as to the projects that government has embarked upon, Bridget, he can easily use his MPs in parliament. I'm on the Select Committee on Roads and Transport. When it comes to loans that government has taken to build infrastructure within that sector, I can tell you offhand.
How much?
You are not here to ask me that.
How much?
I can give you specific projects and how much.
Yes, total.
He even talks about, you know, I think Kumasi Airport, and then he asked the question, was it plated with gold?
I asked the question in Parliament about Kumasi Airport.
Was it plated with gold?
Only 1.9 kilometers of cost 23
billion. Go ahead, continue.
He's there. He lets you answer Kumasi Airport.
Yes, go ahead, please. Yes, specific.
So. It's the same way.
1 minute.
You have your various members of parliament who are on specific committees. The finance committee is there.
Sure.
You have your own Osa Akoto, a very good one, of course. He can tell you how much a government has contracted in terms of certain projects.
That is the exact reason.
But if you just take the Green Book,
you have accounted for some.
They've listed the project.
No, but it's also trying to say that the Baumia doesn't do justice. And then you sum it up and say it doesn't matter.
Some of the loans
you haven't given information.
Used to pay the projects that you embarked upon
when
you
were standing
that you didn't pay for.
I'm just surprised.
One moment. Napo, please, you had your moment.
I know you know that even some of the loans that were contracted were used to pay some of the projects you embarked when you were in office that have not been paid for.
Have you finished?
No, but okay, just tell me whether it is not true.
It is not true. That's why I'm going to tell
you. It is not true. Let me give you an example. Mm-hmm. The Achimota of Ankor Highway. Mm-hmm. You know the initial cost.
The NDC government that's finished the cost. Okay.
You can't just look
at
the
Green Book. What is the cost of the second interchange?
Quantity survey. All right. On that note, we'll have to end the discussion.
I'll tell you. It's around 160 million US dollars.
All right.
That's the financial.
Thank you very much. A very big thank you to Member of Parliament for Mejia South, Dr. Matthew Opoku-Prempeh, Napo, as we like to call him. Also, Professor Chidonu. He is the President of Accra Institute of Technology and also Member of Parliament for Ablekuma Central, Honorable Tese Chai here. Good morning, gentlemen. We've had a fruitful discussion. More than that. Yes. So thank you all for coming here.